Good morning, one and all. We are going to have this important instruction course on achieving 20/20, that is 6x6 post cataract surgery. Achieving 20/20 is a dream of all ophthalmic surgeons in their cataract patients. But there are certain intraoperative scenarios which you need to consider, and you may have faced them. So to solve these intricacies, we have with us eminent ophthalmologist from India and outside India, Dr. Raju Chaudhary from Indore. He runs Rajas Eye Hospital. He's a basically a vitreoretinal surgeon, but he practices cataract also. Raju Chaudhary, sir, please come on the dais. Dr. Praveen Vyavare, who is a cataract and refractive surgeon from Amravati. He has got a lot of experience in dealing with all types of cataract. Dr. Viral Shah, who runs a big hospital at Nagpur and is a volume cataract surgeon. Dr. Arvind Moria from Jodhpur. He is associate professor at AIIMS, Jodhpur. Please, sir. And Dr. Lubna Rehman, she is my student, and she is consultant at Narayana Netralaya. And we have keynote speaker from Bangladesh, Dr. Prakash Chaudhary, who is a director in charge of Bangladesh Eye Hospital and Institute at Chitgaon. He did his fellowship from Raghudeep Eye Clinic, Ahmedabad. So he has Indian connection as well. He has received numerous awards. Prominent amongst them are Firoza Jalil Memorial Award from Ophthalmological Society of Bangladesh, Professor M.A. Mateen Award, awarded by Association of Community Ophthalmology of India. So to begin with, I request Dr. Viral Shah for his talk on perfecting keratometry. Yes, Dr. Viral.
At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Rajesh Joshi, sir, for giving me the opportunity for this IC. I would also like to thank Scientific Committee of AIOS for giving us the opportunity. My talk will be on perfecting keratometry. As you know, essential requirements for any optimal post-surgical outcomes are accurate biometry, fourth generation formulas, personalized lens constants, and accurate corneal power keratometry. Keratometry, as you all know, is the measurement of the corneal curvature, and it can be obtained by many means. A decade ago, the measurement of axial length was commonly felt to be accuracy limiting aspects of IOL power calculations. But this has now changed with the advent of many new generations biometers, optical biometers like IOL masters, lens stars, and whatnot. So the measurement of axial length now is one of the most accurate components, and what is the rate limiting for us for calculating the IOL power is now keratometry measurements. Despite the advances, the technology behind the measurement of central corneal power continues to lag behind. Questions on how best to carry out the keratometry measurements remains a source of uncertainty for physicians and their staff. In a recent study, errors in keratometry were found to be significant cause of for an IOL exchange. Inaccuracies in keratometry have 1:1 correlation, that is 0.75 diopter error in measurement of keratometry will lead to a 0.75 diopter of refractive power surprise. Ophthalmic surgeons frequently accept without question central corneal power values obtained by manual keratometry, autokeratometry, or simulated keratometry. Not all measurements and measurement techniques, however, have the same level of accuracy or are useful for all purposes. Fortunately, some common sense strategies can improve the precision of our readings. To make keratometry as accurate and consistent as possible, we must limit this task to a single instrument for all pre- and post-operative measurements. Autokeratometers, manual keratometer, and simulated keratometers feature of most topographers estimate central corneal power by different methods. For this reason, we should never expect that these three different approaches will always produce the same value for the same eye. Measurement can be made by using topographers, manual keratometers, or CMK readings. The IOL master also measures the axial length and the other ocular parameters such as anterior chamber depth and white-to-white measurements, which includes K reading. The autokeratometer feature of IOL masters or other automated keratometers, they measure a central corneal 2.5 mm zone and utilizes a computer algorithm. Manual keratometer measures a larger, that is 3.2 mm zone, and relies on the operator to set the power difference between principal meridians and their corresponding axis. Furthermore, the simulated keratometry features of a topographer employs yet another method. If we can limit preoperative measurements to a single instrument, we can effectively reduce this. So this shows here that it is measuring central 3.2 mm and the K reading is 44 for this keratometer. Whereas the same eye, the IOL master will measure only 2.5 mm of the central corneal curvature, and lens star will have two rings, 1.7 and 2.3 mm. That's why we get different K readings in the same eye with different keratometers. Manual keratometry provides a clear understanding of the integrity of the precorneal tear film, a dynamic view of the surface of the cornea. With manual keratometry, you have a direct visualization of the reflections generated by the tear film. You can recognize areas of corneal surface irregularity and compromise. You have a much better understanding of the quality and accuracy of the measurement. With automated keratometric measurements, acquisition is static. The measurements are acquired at a moment in time and computer generated. As the instrument operator, you have no appreciation of the accuracy of the measured movement. Keratometry is critical measurement in cataract surgery. If there is any doubt in your K reading, they should be redone on another day. We always repeat K readings if there is any indication of a problem or if the measurement is difficult to acquire. Typically, one should measure the right eye followed by the left eye and then repeat to verify. If the patient has dry eye disease or comes wearing contact lenses, have the patient return after dry eye treatment and no contact lens wear for at least 1 to 3 weeks depending on the lens type. Your first K measurement may not be the one you use for your surgery. If you are taking measurement for cataract surgery, it's the first thing you'd want to do before instilling drops for performing gonioscopy, tonometry, or anything that may compromise the corneal surface. Although it's not hard to learn, it takes a little practice. You need to be confident in your measurements. At many reputed institutes, only doctors, including residents, will perform keratometry for patients planned for cataract surgery. Some surgeons prefer the most updated automated K reading for their surgeries. It's smart to compare manual with automated. Also, one should expect correlation of the measured corneal cylinder with the patient's spectacles. So the tips for keratometry is no drops before measurement, especially dilating drops. No staring before measurements. Always ask your patient to blink, 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 and then open wide and take the measurements. Managing the corneal surface before ocular surface is always very important. Clinical clues can be picked up during keratometric measurement that help you identify more subtle corneal degenerations, such as basement membrane dystrophy, that can be more difficult to identify and easy to overlook on the slit lamp. Anytime the operator has difficulty in generating a measurement, immediately try to identify why. It could be dry eye, a compromised cornea, meibomian gland dysfunction, corneal disease, or even poor patient positioning or poor fixation during examination. Why are case subtypes inaccurate? Data is not a ring and not from a zone. Actual power of posterior cornea is unknown. Keratometry versus topo or tomo, CMK, a ring of 4 to 24 points from 1.7 to 3.2 millimeters, as already shown with two diopter fit, is taken. Whereas in zonal case, 16,000 to 40,000 points from zone with 3D fit is taken. So for the same cornea, manual keratometer will be measuring 44, the IOL master will be measuring 44.3, and lens star will be measuring power of 44.5, because they take the reading from the steeper central part of the cornea. And this is why a constant for all the different methods changes, because in if you are doing a immersion technology, your a constant is slightly lower than when you are doing IOL biometer. The difference lies here in the corneal diameters. If the standard deviation obtained by this automated keratometers is more than plus minus 0.2 diopters, then you have to repeat the keratometry, and you are not sure about this keratometry. It can be a dry eye. So you, once you treat the dry eye, you can see the difference 6 weeks after treatment of the dry eye. Always look at this standard deviation value. If it is within confidence limit, less than 0 plus minus 0.20, then only you are supposed to take this reading. If this is here, it is 0, so we are able to take this reading. Whereas in this, the standard deviation, you can see it is around 6 microns and 13 microns. So different corneal disorders can be picked out by this keratometry: asymmetric bow tie, early keratoconus, post LASIK. In keratoconus, always remember that it's never a perfect bow tie. Always do topography, tomography when correcting astigmatism. In toric, whenever you are planning for a toric IOL, you have to do a topography or a tomography. In general, we should consider a corneal topographer to be more of a big picture instrument and not a substitute for standard keratometry. The axial map feature of many topography is an excellent tool for objectively determining the steep axis of regular astigmatism. In general, a second person should confirm the measurement and sign the chart only if any of the following is occurring in your measurements: measurement to measurement inconsistency, very flat or steep, diopteric difference, and K1, K2, difference of more than 3 diopters or astigmatism more than 4 diopters. So this is the corneal power decision tree. Whenever you are taking, always try to go by this tree and you will 99.9% fall within your confidence limits. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Viral, for highlighting on importance of keratometry. Now I request Dr. Praveen Vyavare to speak on IOL power calculation in various situations. I request all the speakers to stick to their time. We are going to take the lectures first and then the questions afterwards.
To begin with, I would like to thank Dr. Rajesh for giving me the wonderful opportunity and to include me in his instruction course. My topic is IOL power calculation in various situations. So I do not have any financial interest in this presentation. Now, when you talk about IOL calculation in a normal situation, if you go to the history in 1970s or early 80s, people used to just add 19 diopter in a pre-cataract refraction. And this is a typical formula, a two-variable formula, where the formula is developed considering or taking into account only the axial length and keratometry. So the effective lens position used to get calculated by only keratometry and the axial length. So that was the most important and big fallacy in this two variable formula. And then the next formula came with the new generation formula. So the older generation formula used to take into account only the axial length and keratometry. So that why these formula worked very well only in the normal eyes with normal NDA chamber depth and normal axial length. But in extreme eyes with a shallow NDA chamber or deep anterior chamber, a very small eye or a big eye, these formula didn't do well. So the people came up with the next generation formula and newer formulas, and Holiday 2 takes into account almost 6 variables. And so these newer formula works well in all eyes, including a high myopic or very short eyes. So the latest being a Barrett 2 and Hill RBF. Hill of RBF works very well in extreme eyes, like a very long eyes or very short eyes. So if you are using a SRK T formula, and if you get a patient of high axial myo, here you can have an error. The reason being, your axial length is not calculated properly, because the if you are using an IOL master or a ultrasound, a light or sound when passes through the aqueous and through the vitreous has a different velocity, and the routine machine averages this velocity. In a routine eye, there is a fixed proportion of anterior chamber versus vitreous chamber. But in a very deep eyes, you have a very big vitreous chamber, this average or proportion goes off or goes haywire. So being the velocity of light or sound is less in a vitreous than in an aqueous, and it has to travel more, the machine assume a more axial length and can get a hypermetropic surprise. So this is a problem when we put this axial length in the older formula. So if you get a patient of high axial myope and you are using a SRKT formula or any second or third generation formula, then you need to adjust the axial length. You may have a hypermetropic surprise. So the you can deal this with having some amount of myopia, targeting some amount of myopia, or you can use a higher formula like a Barrett. And here you can adjust your axial length and put it in the SRKT formula so that you can get the exact or adjusted axial length, and then you can put this axial length in SRKT and you can have a proper calculation. The another situation is a post-LASIK or post-keratorefractive situation. In a post-refractive keratometry situation, the standard keratometry doesn't give you the exact corneal power, the reason being a keratometric index error, radius error, and formula error. What happens here is the your relationship between the anterior corneal surface and posterior corneal surface is not normal. So this keratometric index of 1.3375, what we use to take for calculation, doesn't apply here, and you can have this keratometric index error. In RK and myopic LASIK versus PRK, in RK you are altering both anterior surface as well as posterior surface, and in PRK and myopia LASIK you are altering or you are flattening the anterior surface only, your posterior surface of cornea remains same. The another error is the radius error. Whenever the particular instrument measures the cornea, it doesn't measure exact central point, it measures the paracentral points. And the machine extrapolates the data of central power from this paracentral point, and because of that, it overestimates the central power and you can get a hypermetropic surprise. The formula error, when you're using a two variable formula like SRKT, the SRKT predicts the ELP taking into account the keratometry. Here your keratometry is altered, you have a very flat K, so the formula assume a flat or shallow or less ELP and you can get hypermetropic surprise again. So if you want to do a calculation in post-keratorefractive procedures, a post-keratorefractive patient, then you need to do use a formula like a myopic Hagis L or Halide 2, so that you need not to take into account this problem. And there is another method, that is Aramberry single K or double K method, in which you can use a pre-operative or pre-LASIK K to predict the effective lens position and use a post-refractive K for calculation in a fourth generation formula. Or you can use a single K method where you don't have to do anything, you just need to adjust the axial length depending on the refractive correction and axial length, you need to adjust the power of the lens. So there are so many methods, more than 20 methods to calculate a post-keratorefractive IOL power calculation. It itself indicates that none of this method is very accurate and very reliable. So you have to prepare yourself and you need to counsel your patient that you may have or you may get some amount of refractive surprise in this type of patient. So the most easiest, or in hypermetropic LASIK, what happens? Your anterior cornea becomes stiff, so there is not much variation between the anterior cornea and posterior cornea. So if you have a central 4 millimeter average on topography or in post-RK also, then you can have a predictable keratometry readings post-surgery, and you can put these readings in newer generation formula to have a proper IOL power. And the most easiest, and what I use, is use a post ASCRS calculator. You put a data and you will get a different calculation according to different formulas, and it also gives a IOL power, average IOL power of all formulas. So the another situation is silicon filled eyes. What happens in silicon filled eyes is basically the velocity of light or velocity of sound is different in silicon oil as compared to the vitreous. It is slower in the silicon oil. So you need to adjust the velocity on ultrasound machine, or if you are using or taking into account the same velocity, you need to use a conversion factor of 0.71 calculate or multiply the axial length you got into 0.71 and you will get the actual axial length. Or if you're using an oil master, and that is what is advised, you should have a silicon oil filled eye mode. And again, if the eye is not filled completely, then there is a problem in calculation sometimes. Just 1 minute more, Rajesh. Last slide. Okay. And silicon filled eyes, if you use a convex or plano lens, a plano surface on the posterior side, then you may not get an IOL power surprise. And in a posterior staphyloma cases, this is another unusual situation. If you use an ultrasound, then ultrasound will measure the anatomic axis and not the refractive axis. And you can have a surprise because your fovea may be at the edge of posterior staphyloma and not into the center of the staphyloma. So it is better to use an IOL master in these cases and ask the patient to fix it into the at the light. So thank you very much. Perfection is achieved not when there is nothing more to add, but when there is nothing left to take away. Thank you again.
Thanks, Dr. Praveen. Now we have Dr. Arvind Moria from AIIMS Jodhpur. He will be showing some videos as he has got some commitment, so he's coming before me.
Good morning, everyone, and thanks, Dr. Joshi, for giving me this opportunity. Play the video, please. So this was a case of complicated cataract with 360 degree of posterior synechia. So we entered through the side port and tried to break the synechia. Iris atrophy was there. We tried hard to break this synechia and to dilate the pupil to get adequate pupillary dilatation and then able to do the phaco emulsification. But that didn't happen. So now we need either the iris retractors or the rings, the pupil expander rings. So I second side port was made, and this is how it is loaded, the Gupta's pupillary expander ring. Three channels were tugged with the help of the injector only. And the last one was tugged with the help of a dialer. So now we have adequate pupillary dilatation and we can start with our capsular access and complete the phaco emulsification. And there was no glow, as you can see, because it was a total white cataract. So in such cases, the capsular access is also very difficult. Then we started to stop and chop, but it was very soft. So by using the chip and flip technique, the nucleus was emulsified. It was retugged, and then the heparin coated lens was implanted, hydrophobic, into the bag. This patient also had 10 degree of exotropia. And after doing this phaco, the eye was well centered and the vision came to 6/9. Next video, please. Volume, please.
And it was brought out by a gentle use of.
So this was a case, post keratoplasty patient, and these were the details, 32-year-old male, and the K1, K2 were 29 and 41.84. So we had this toric aisle made, customized, of 12 diopter.
A moderate size side port was made. Air dye visco were injected. It is mandated to inject dye in this case Due to pre-existing haze at the graft host junction, a continuous curvilinear capsular excess was made, which was shorter than the graft in this case. Also, the amount of viscoelastic substance injected before making the excess should be moderate. Care should be taken not to balloon up the anterior chamber, else it will lead to loosening up of the sutures. A 2.8 mm entry using a keratome was made. An entry was made 1.5 to 2 mm behind the graft host junction. Gentle hydrodissection is done, following which a part of the nucleus was in the anterior chamber, and a presence of a golden ring indicates an efficient hydrodissection. Phacoemulsification was done at low parameters. The bottle height was kept between 40 to 60 and vacuum was kept at 200. 25% of the nucleus was removed by phaco and the rest by hydro, and it was brought out by a gentle use of 2% HPMC. By putting pressure at the lip of main incision, soft nucleus with the cortex comes out easily, and marking for toric IOL at 11 degree was done. And while loading, the trailing haptic should rest over the optic of the intraocular lens, and then the cartridge is tucked into the injector. Then first haptic is placed, following which centration into the bag 5 to 10 degree away from the desired axis was done. Then visco removal was done, followed by final placement of the lens at 11 degree. Closure of the wound using hydro was done, and air was injected. However, the anterior chamber was not taut in this case, so one suture was placed at the main incision. And also it should be taken care of that hydro should not spread to the graft host junction.
So the vision came to 6 by 24, and from 2 meter finger counting. And this is the last one. This is a case of a jeweler, and very high myope. So we were very reluctant to implant a trifocal in this patient, but patient was very much adamant. So we ordered again a customized trifocal intraocular lens of 6.5 diopter. The ACD was very high, more than four. So it was prolapsed into the AC, the nucleus, because I am a hypermetrope, then divided into two with the help of this visco cannula. Then at very low parameters and low bottle height, first piece was emulsified, then the second one. In high myopes, always keep the bottle height on the lower side and all the parameters also. Then the cortex was removed with the help of this Simco cannula. Polishing was done. Then 6.5 diopter of trifocal was implanted. And fortunately, the vision came to 6 by 6 part, distance, good intermediate, and N6. First haptic is in the back. Now it was dialed. It's completely in the back. Thank you.
Thank you, Arvind sir, for nice videos. Now, in our chain of achieving 2020 post-cataract surgery, we have the master himself, our chief instructor, Dr. Rajesh Joshi sir from Nagpur. He will be speaking on managing astigmatism to achieve 2020. Astigmatism, as you we all know, is the major roadblock in achieving the 2020 vision.
I don't have any financial interest in this presentation. Now, what is the need for correcting astigmatism to have unaided 20 by 20 vision and improve the quality of the vision? If you have come across a patient having astigmatism, if he's got a small amount of astigmatism like 0.5 or 0.25, he has more complaints than the same amount of the sphere. So that is a need for correcting astigmatism. But sometimes you may see dissatisfied patient having minus cylinder at 90 degree, because they will complain to you that I was able to see near objects without glasses, Then after implanting of the toric IOL, they need glasses. So that could be the problem. So you have to properly counsel the patient for toric IOLs. 22% of the cataract candidates which are present to us for surgery, they have some amount of the astigmatism. Clinically significant is plus minus one diopter. More common is against the rule astigmatism, and less are with the rule and the oblique astigmatism. So to begin with, if you are performing first time toric IOL, consider the patient who are having against the rule astigmatism. And most of the cataract surgeons, they perform phacoemulsification through the temporal clear corneal incision. So they don't have to move to other side or something like that. They can perform cataract surgery as they want, whatever technique they are following, and just implant an IOL at 0-180 degree. These are the various ways to correct the astigmatism. There could be spectacles, contact lenses, but with contact lenses in old patients, they are difficult. You can have laser vision correction afterwards also, or incisional corneal surgeries like limbar relaxing incision or astigmatic keratotomy. But they have their disadvantages. They are unpredictable, variable. There may be regression or recurrence of the astigmatism, and they may need additional incision on the cornea. They cause weakening of the cornea. Sometimes they may lead to corneal infections as well. So toric IOL is the way to go. And what different you need to do? Perfect keratometry, as has been elaborated by Dr. Viral. Reference and axis marking. Aligning of the IOL and removal of the complete viscoelastic from the bag. These are the main prerequisites for having a perfect 20/20 vision after post-cataract surgery in patients implanted with toric IOL. Now, what are the candidates which are suitable? Primary corneal astigmatism. There should not be other conditions like a patient having subluxated lenses and you want to implant endocapsular ring, that can cause stretching of the zonules and they may defeat the purpose of implanting intraocular lens with the toric curvature. Patients with corneal pathology like Fuchs and stromal dystrophy are not suitable because they may not get proper vision postoperatively. Now, patient's evaluation is very important. Whenever patient comes to me for cataract surgery, I usually see their glasses, if they are carrying cylinder in their glasses or not, then carry out keratometry. Autorefractometry can be a rough guide if you perform autorefractometry during routine, as a routine for your cataract patient. That may give some clue about if there any variation in the dioptric power. Now, calculating IOL power should be perfect. No contact scan, only immersion or optical biometer. These are the toric calculators. They are available online. And whatever IOLs you are using, those companies, they have prepared their app. And you have to just feed up the values of keratometry, then IOL power, and whatever axis of astigmatism is there. You need to repeat the keratometry. This has been told by Dr. Viral, so I will not repeat the things. Reference marking, there are various reference markers which are available. Before you go for toric IOL, you have to mark 0-180 degree. So there are various methods which are available, but in my view, the best is on slit lamp. You have to align the horizontal optical beam of the slit lamp at 0-180 degree in the center optic of the cornea. And that is how you can mark either with 26 gauge needle, but make sure that the marks remain in the mid periphery of the cornea, because sometimes they smudge during the surgery, or you may not be able to properly see them during implantation of the IOL. But there are various limitations of manual marking. Error may be there, marks may spread. Difficult to see these marks intraoperatively. So image guided systems, they have come up with their markings, but I don't have any experience about this image guided system. Now, what is the basis of this toric IOL? IOL marks on the toric IOL represent the flat curvature of the IOL to be matched with the steep meridian of the cornea. So roughly, if you have 42 and 44 diopter of the corneal curvature, make you see on the online calculator, your marks should be at the steeper median, that is 44 degree. These are the instruments to mark the axis on the table. On the left hand side, this is 0 to 360 degree, whatever axis you want to place for your toric IOL that you can mark, and this is the marker which guides to your particular axis, like 0, 180 degree or 40, 140 degree, like that. Intraoperative alignment, you can grossly place the IOL inside the back around 10 degree away from your previous marking in the clockwise direction. So at the end, you can align it properly. And of course, viscoelastic removal is very important, because most common cause for rotation of IOL postoperatively is viscoelastic behind the IOL. And the final alignment, you can check it. You have to wait for around 5 minutes, make sure that the marks are well placed, and then only ask the patient to go to his room. There are various IOLs which are available, hydrophobic, acrylic, hydrophilic acrylic, PMMA, and silicone. The best is hydrophobic acrylic. This small video about this implantation of toric IOL, these are the marks, and you have to place the marks on the IOL, on the markings of the cornea, and make sure that you clean the viscoelastic from behind the IOL. The best thing you can do, if you don't want to remove the viscoelastic at the end of the surgery, you can put IOL under the BSS. This is the rexis marking forceps. The first mark is of 2.5 and the second mark is of 5 millimeter. If you don't have a rexis marker, you can have this type of arrangement in your rexis forceps. So once you align the 2.5 mark, whatever diameter of rexis you are getting is of 5 millimeter. There could be refractive surprises after IOL. You need to go to this ascrs.com site and put your whatever dioptric whatever change which has occurred, and that calculates, and then you can realign. So take home message is, astigmatic correction with toric IOL is more safe, effective, and stable. Accurate keratometry and reference marking is important, and complete overlap of optic by CCC and complete removal of viscoelastic is essential. Thanks for your patience listening.
Thank you, Rajesh sir. Now, for achieving Vision 2020, one of the most important dreaded catastrophe that can occur intraoperative is posterior capsular rent. But we have got a stalwart with us from Indore, Dr. Raju Chaudhary sir. He will be speaking. Even if you have PCR, Vision 2020 is a achievable dream, sir.
Good morning, friends. Thank you, Rajesh, for having me here. Posterior capsular rent is one of the most fear, and everybody fears for every either simple case, complicated case, and probably this is our the primary most important fear. Whether they are the beginner, where they are the senior or expert, everybody fears. So I am going to cover some of the few points to be taken care. So there are different predisposing factor. If your mic, their basic machine is not good, sudden surge, but they are not the old problem, microscope, deep set eye, prominent eyebrows, disorder of spine. There are multiple issue, anterior chamber depth is low, iris and pupillary factor, multiple problem with the capsule lens and genules. There is the incidence. So what is the primary aim? So main aim is to avoid the posterior dislocation of the nucleus, epinucleus, or cortical matter that should not go. Prevent any damage to the cordial endothelium while managing the surgery. And one of the important, prevent enlargement of the tear. Whatever had happened, we should be careful that it should not enlarge more. Prevent enlargement of rexis. Maintain wood size. Remove leftover cortex. And to give the proper position of the, this is the most common time when you are when PCR can occur, is a emulsification of last piece during IA, when we are more relaxed during PC polishing. So there are the few signs which are the to recognize how early you recognize the PCR when the nucleus is there, then how then you are more effectively able to manage. Sudden deepening, transitory sudden appearance of the red glow, you are not able to move your nucleus probably, reducing the efficacy of nucleus sculpting, and tilting of the nucleus is one of the few signs that this is the video showing how the hard brown cataract, you just watch. And many times you see that you are not done nothing, but it's just I have done the hydro. I slightly push to save the fluid out. And you see that it become a deep and the nucleus is slightly going back. So this is the first sign that then you are sculpting and you feel you try to rotate and you feel that it's slightly hard and it is coming back. That is called spring action. It means if you realize at that time, you are more effectively managed. Otherwise, you may increase the, and then you notice that backside there is a rent. Here it is the, you can see enlarged red reflex. So what we should do once there is some basic point. Use your reflex if you catch hold of the during IA, if you have catch hold of the posterior capsule, so that if you suddenly remove that probe, you will increase the rent because the capsule will come with you. So as soon as you notice, use the reflex and try to avoid this extension to go beyond. Many times you catch hold of the capsule and you are using the reflex and it is not going, reflex is not, because that so much amount of the capsule is inside the IA tip that it will not. So you keep your probe steady and use the spatula to dislodge this. It may turn, but if you withdraw this, you are going to lose all of your beak. So this is important to recognize, early recognize, so you can take a prompt measure to so to avoid sudden. This is another case. If you there's a posterior polar, you are careful. You should be careful because there is a rent. You see. So once you want to withdraw, you should not withdraw immediately the probe. Inject visco so that your chamber remain maintained, and so this will avoid your extension. Then if you notice the hard brown cataract, so important is to achieve 20/20 proper placement and proper calculation. Sometimes if you are not able to put the lens in the back, and if you are putting here, it is the rent. You can see that is the rent, and the large chunk of the nucleus is remaining. If we start emulsifying, we will pull up the vitreous. If we go for vitrectomy, lens can fall. So best option is to oil scaffolding, put the intraocular lens before removing this piece, and then very easily you can intraocular lens. And you can it's not moving. not going far. Okay. If you have the best thing, you can do the vitrectomy here. Fill with the vitreous, and you can see that many times you use the triamcinolone before putting intraocular lens, and many times you can do after the, so to identify the vitreous in the anterior chamber, and you can. This is one of the important videos. It is having the pre-existing tear. This I wanted to show, posterior polar. You can see an elliptical tear. Pre-existing tear is there. Still, we can perform the surgery very well. Staining is important in this. You can identify the rim. I will just show this video. Because this is big. Gentle hydrodelineation, because already pre-existing rent is there. Nucleus is soft, we can emulsify and aspirate. Aspiration. Nucleus is out. Now, still the vitreous is there. You can have the vitrectomy from the pars plana, triamcinolone, to identify the to the anterior vitrectomy. Either you can do with the two port, or you can go for the pars plana so that you can withdraw the vitreous. Once you have, the important is to place the lens. If you are able to, here the three-piece lens is, should be used. You can put it in the bag, and you can capture, optic capture the anteriorly, or if you put the lens in the haptic in the sulcus, you can put the reverse capture of the. So these are a few more video. So in short, early recognition, prompt management for PCR and vitreous prolapse, we can give a good visual outcome. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for showing various scenarios of posterior capsular rent and how we can achieve 20/20 in this patient. Next in the row is Dr. Lubna Zamir. I request her to present her slides.
Thank you, Dr. Joshi, sir, for including me in this IC. Good morning, everyone. My topic for today is managing odd situations in cataract surgery. Dr. Chaudhary, sir, has shown one of the complications which is most dreaded for a phaco surgeon, especially when you're a beginner. I'm going to touch upon a few odd situations which we generally don't hear or read about, but we often encounter in our day-to-day practice. So let's begin with some wound-related issues. So if you have a very large wound with a leaky wound, you will have the most free structure in the eye, that is the iris, coming out through it time and again. And this not only poses a challenge in inserting and removing your instrument, but it also poses a challenge while performing the phacoemulsification. Then similarly, if you have a very tight wound, it poses again a difficulty in inserting and removing your instruments, as well as not allowing adequate irrigation to take place. Sometimes because of faulty blades, you may have a very irregular entry. And sometimes due to excessive manipulation, you may have an irregular internal or external lip. So how do you manage? The first things first, you must take a few extra seconds and construct your incisions on time. I feel almost 10% of your surgical outcome depends on good incisions, and then next comes rexis. So you must make sure your blades are sharp, if not new, and make good, slow trapezoid incisions which are of adequate size and they are watertight. If you still have an irregular wound, there is no shame in suturing your incision so that you can assure watertightness. And especially if you are dealing with an unhealthy looking cornea, it's always better to take a suture right at your incision as well as your side port. So like I was mentioning, a good trapezoid, biplanar or triplanar clear corneal incision will be watertight for long. Another not so uncommon encounter that we have is that of a floppy iris. The intraoperative floppy iris syndrome is generally supposed to be a triad where the iris stroma tends to bow all the time. The iris tends to come out through the main port as well as through the side port, even when you have made good incisions. And there is a progressive pupillary constriction. So there are triple challenges when you are performing your surgery. You can see that every time you're inserting or removing an instrument or manipulating intraocularly, you will see that the iris tends to come out through the incision. You can also have iris prolapse, as you can see here, when you are performing irrigation aspiration. Even though you're not manipulating that particular incision, you see that the iris comes out. So the floppy iris syndrome, generally we blame a drug called as tamsulosin, which is an alpha-1 antagonist. This is used to relax the smooth vessels in prostate and bladder neck in BPH, but it also relaxes the iris dilator muscle and hence the triad. The management depends upon the severity, and unfortunately there is no sure shot way to diagnose it before you start your surgery, but you can use certain pharmacologic measures to maintain good dilatation. Micro incisions would be better, including the use of a high cohesive viscoelastic would keep the iris behind. Low fluidic parameters to avoid anterior chamber fluctuation, and mechanical dilating devices like hooks and rings can also be used. Rex's misadventures, we've all been there. The certain scenarios which I want to show are especially in intumescent cataracts, whether mature or immature. And you may not always have the typical Argentinian flag sign. Here, this is an immature cataract, intumescent type, and the surgeon is attempting to perform the Rex's when he's not able to see the anterior capsule very well. Then tries to insert viscoelastic to remove the air bubbles, and the intralenticular pressure rises and the rexate extends, even though this is not a mature intumescent cataract. A similar case scenario. So the point to remember is increase intralenticular pressure in intumescent cataracts. There you go, you see the Argentinian flag sign. And in the fifth case, the capsule got damaged while inserting the cystitome, so you have a very odd looking tear on the anterior capsule. So how do you manage that? Like I was mentioning, increased intralenticular pressure is generally to blame in intumescent cataracts. So we must make sure our incisions are watertight and the anterior chamber pressure is well maintained. Now how would you do that? Let us see first the management of these. So we will try to debulk the cataract as far as possible by gentle irrigation under low parameters. And then refashion the rexis from another side and join it back to the point of tear. At any point of time, if you feel or have even the slightest doubt that the rexis probably has extended to the posterior capsule, do not progress with your phaco because you are sure to have a drop. You may also manage with the help of a capsulotomy, but thereafter you should not proceed with phaco. Here again, the rexis is being fashioned. And in the last case, you can start afresh from another point on the anterior capsule and include the torn part of the anterior capsule within the rexis so you have a smooth CCC. This is a soft shield technique which we can use in hard cataracts as well as intumescent mature cataracts, wherein you spread the dispersive OVD under the endothelium, which protects the endothelium during phaco procedure, and then insert a cohesive OVD underneath it. So this kind of creates a bolus and keeps the anterior chamber pressure high for long. Now, Desmond's detachment is something which haunts us all. So this was a case in which the surgeon attempted wound-assisted viscoelastic insertion without actually going into the anterior chamber, and there you can see the Desmoids is getting detached. This is a similar case in which there was a total Desmoid detachment and the surgeon had not realized it. You may also get a hemidesmoid detachment where only half of the Desmoids is detached. Or if you excessively manipulate your side ports or incisions, you may get a sectional Desmoid detachment just at the side of the section. Now, how would you manage this? We could always inject air, but this may not be enough and it may not oppose for long, especially in large DMDs. You can also inject air as well as suture the Desmoids to the cornea. It's called as desmoidopexy. And lastly, you have the option of C3F8 gas injection in the dilution of 1:7, 14% isoexpansyl C3F8. And in these cases, we do get decent amount of apposition because it stays there for at least 12 to 14 days. It's hung. Sorry for that. There are too many videos in this file, so it's...
I think you can tell the few scenarios which are there and for which you are not able to show the videos.
And Asa, it's running now. So I will show a case of zonular dialysis. Now this looks like a very benign kind of a cataract. The surgeon goes in with good incisions, good rexis, good hydro and everything. And just the fact that the nucleus is on the harder side. So all the focus is on cracking the nucleus. And you see blindly the surgeon tries to go in the periphery and attempts to crack and has actually gone on the anterior surface of the capsular rim and pulled it along. So there you go, you can see the zonular dialysis there. This was a similar case in which intraocularly the surgeon had zonular dialysis and capsular hooks were used to keep the capsule in place while performing the surgery, while finishing the surgery. Phacoemulsification was performed under low parameters. A CTR was implanted to keep the bag in place. And then IOL was implanted. The capsular hooks were removed. So this is what sir had shown. Now Titanic is good only in movies. You know what I'm talking about. This was a case of pseudo-exfoliation syndrome. The pupil was not dilating with a very hard cataract. Iris hooks are in place and the surgeon is attempting to crack the nucleus. And before you know, there you go. So we don't have a much option other than handing it over to our retina friends for picking out the pieces. So yes, this is something which we encounter especially in the initial stages of doing premium IOL practice. So these are a few scenarios in which case one, when you're injecting the IOL, the cartridge just splits. I'm sure you've all been through this. Case two, you have loaded the IOL well, but it just somehow gets stuck in the incision. The third thing, where the optic goes in, but the haptic is stuck. A fourth scenario, where you have implanted and the IOL just flips. The fifth scenario is when you have the optic goes in, the whole lens goes in, but with a broken haptic. And the last thing In case of over-enthusiastic injection, you know what is going to be the next one, next step. So how do you manage this? In case you have a split cartridge, all you have to do is salvage your IOL, reload and reimplant. If you have a stuck IOL, the same thing, salvage your IOL, reload and reimplant. In the third case, when you have a stuck haptic, you can try to split your cartridge with the help of a sharp instrument and then reimplant the IOL. In case of flipped IOL, what I like to do is do it under irrigation and aspiration. And many a times, if you have a good, decent space, you can do it without any catastrophe. And if you have a broken haptic, you have no option but to cut it through with the help of IOL cutting forceps and remove them. So my tip for all people who are beginning generally is, what I tell them is, you must load your own IOLs and load it under good light, especially if possible under a microscope, so that you see nothing is stuck anywhere in the cartridge. Realign your injector properly. Don't go in full thrust. Go in soft pulses. Go slow and see at every point of time whether the optic that is getting unfolded is unfolding in the proper manner. Especially if you're doing premium IOL practice, a flip will not, and the patient will not pardon you if you have a flip of your IOL. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lubna, for highlighting on various scenarios. Now we have our keynote speaker, Dr. Prakash Chaudhary. He's from Bangladesh, and he's a director in charge, Bangladesh Eye Hospital and Institute, Chitgaon. But he has got an Indian connection as well. He has done fellowship from Raghudeep Eye Clinic. He will be speaking on various finer points in small, managing the small pupil. Over to you, sir.
A very good morning. At the outset, I convey my heartiest thanks to Dr. Rajesh Joshi and the organizer to give me the opportunity to use this podium. And I would like to share my experience about the management of a small pupil. The main problem with the small pupil, the visualization is compromised and difficult to create optimum size axis, and that affects all steps of the phacosurgery, starting from the capsular axis to the IOL implantations. If the pupil is fairly well dilated, so that can be managed without pupil expansion device. And to manage the pupil without pupil expansion device, I first use the preservative-free lignocaine, then use adrenaline under the iris to improve the dilatations of the pupil. This is to some extent is helpful. Then I use high molecular weight cohesive OBD, which is unique to dilate the pupil. But if the pupil is small due to the posterior Sonica or fibrosis of the pupillary margins, then intracameral mydriatics or cohesive OBD is not effective. So 360 degree Sonicolysis through the side port with the spatula is crucial to improve the dilatations of the pupil. I prefer to stain the anterior capsules with tip and blow under soft shell technique to make complete axis more confidently and more safely. First, inject the dispersive OBD through the side port. Then I inject the cohesive OBD under the dispersive OBD, which will push the dispersive OBD upwards and outwards to line the corneal endothelium. Then I inject the tip and blow under the cohesive OBD. And during injection, the dye is spread mechanically using the undersurface of the cannula. I found this technique is much better than the air bubble technique, because it does not allow the anterior chamber and pupil to get collapsed and greatly improve the visibility of the anterior capsule without touching the corneal endothelium. Creation of optimum size axis is very challenging with the small pupil. It is wise to follow the pupillary margin to achieve large axis as much as possible. And repeated injection of cohesive OBD is a good idea to keep the pupil dilate. I prefer to hydro dissection in the multi-quadrant with a small band hydro cannula. And every time I inject very small amount of fluid. And after every inject, I decompress the nucleus so that there is no fluid pressure build up behind the iris. Otherwise, excessive fluid pressure, if build up behind the iris, that will cause iris prolapse and will make the pupil small. Enough deep sculpting is the prerequisites to divide the nucleus into multiple small fragments. I prefer to do downslope sculpting as much as possible with the low bottle height and low aspiration flow rate. Here I am using 80% torsional ultrasound as it is hard cataract, but my aspiration flow rate is only 20 cc to reduce the injury to the posterior capsule with my phaco probe. And to divide the nucleus, I prefer a stop and chop technique with high Bcom. Here I am using 350 plus Bcom for a good hold on the nucleus. But the aspiration flow rate is only 20 cc. So there is a less chance to catch the posterior capsules. Again, the bottle height also very less to reduce the inflow. Because once there is TP is occluded, there is only inflow. There is no outflow. So if your bottle height is more, there is a more inflow, and that will cause this increased pressure gradient behind the iris, and that will cause iris prolapse and will make the pupil small. So this is something we have to always keep in mind. And optimum fluidic parameter is a good idea to deal with the small pupil. So you have to always keep in mind the output should be matched with the input. And slow motion phaco with the torsional ultrasound is more useful than the longitudinal ultrasound to avoid the increased fluid turbulence, because with increased fluid turbulence, the pupil may become small. Slow motion phaco also helpful to stay the viscoelastic substance into the anterior chambers. And the torsional ultrasound is simply great to maintain the, to manage the pupil, small pupil, because it has outstanding cutting efficiency as it cut the lens in more than one direction, so there is no repulsion, no conflict between the energy and aspiration, and greatly enhance the fallibility to bring the lens matter close to the phaco tip, which is very crucial when you deal with the small pupil, and also greatly maintain the stability of the anterior chamber. Another important thing, always you have to emulsify the fragments in the center of the direct, under direct visualization. And it is very important to inject OBD before the removal of instrument through the side port to maintain the stability of the anterior chamber, which is crucial to maintain the size of the pupil. I use the cohesive OBD before the implantations of the IOL because of its highly elastic and viscous property. It creates better space and maintain the size of the pupils. And it is very important to check the when you implant the IOL, so that both the haptics are goes to the back. And here I'm checking the axis margins over the IOL. And removal of cohesive OBD also easy because they have long chain molecule which is highly entangled with each others. And removal of OBD from back of the IOL also very important, because if any OBD is left behind, that will cause a high rise of postoperative intraocular pressures. But the pupil expansion device is the best option to manage the small pupil more confidently and more safely. And because by pupil expansion device, we can achieve the large stable surgical field. There are many options. One useful device is the iris hook, which fixes the iris with the limbus. So this is the strongest one. There are some ring device also that support the pupillary margins, though they are not as strong as the iris hook, but the postoperative iris distortion is less than the iris hook. And we all know the technique how to use the iris hook. First, we make a stable incision at the limbus as posteriorly as possible in a diamond configurations. And here I'm using 1 mm, then I pass the iris hook. I prefer 4 iris hook. Some surgeons, they prefer 5 iris hook. Then inject OBD under the iris to elevate the iris. And this is helpful to engage the hook to the pupillary margins and make it tight to achieve the round configurations. And the main advantage of the iris hook, it is cheap, it is easy to, you can reuse, but the main disadvantage is it needs some extra time, it needs some extra paracentesis. And removal also easy, just push forwards and then turn it around and make it out. This is the case of intraoperative myosis. You see, before a start operation, the pupil was well dilated, but after making the side port, I inject the intracameral lidocaine, and it was surprising the pupil had become very small. So this is a small pupil. So after using the iris hook, I managed the case, and the case was successfully managed, and phaco was complete. And another pupil expansion device is the B-hex flexible hexagonal device, which is created by Shubhen Bhattacharya. It has 6 flanges, 3 flanges has hole out of, and 3 flanges has no hole, and 6 notches. So you can introduce the ring, throw the main incisions with the 23 gauge forceps into the anterior chamber and place it over the iris, and then throw the side port with the grasps the flanges with the hole and push it behind the iris, and simultaneously two notches on the flanges and engage to the papillary margins. So this is very wonderful device I found. I am using quite, and removal also very easy. Just simply disengage the ring from the papillary margins, then with the support of the second, I use the second instrument as support and pull it out through the main port. It is very easy to remove. This is the best part of this device. Thank you so much for patience hearing.
We have 5 minutes to go for the completion of this course. We can take up one or two questions on whatever topics which we have covered. If there are no queries, I announce that this course is over, and thanks for your patience listening. Thank you.